Good evening. My name is Michael Ritchie, and 12 years ago, I had the distinct pleasure, the honor, and the daunting task of following Gordon Davidson as the artistic director of the Center Theatre Group. And when I received the phone call from the headhunter, the head of the search firm, one night to tell me that I was going to be officially offered the job the next day, he said, I want to remind you of something, and I want you to sleep on this tonight before you make your decision. He said, you're following a founder. This could go one of two ways. It could either be very, very, very difficult, or it could be disastrous. And the truth is, I did have some difficulties in my first few years here, but you know, upon an honest reflection many years later, most, if not all, of those difficulties were self-imposed. And in fact, all of them were softened or mitigated or even eliminated because of the support that I got and the generosity of spirit that was given to me by Gordon Davidson. I stand here now after 12 years, and I think that if I've done any good in those 12 years, or if I do any good in the coming years, it's all because I've been blessed with the opportunity to stand on the shoulders of a giant. Tonight, we honor Gordon, but it is not a farewell. Anytime any of us walk into a theater, whether it's here in Los Angeles, across the country, even around the world, we walk into that theater with Gordon Davidson. He has affected not just dozens or hundreds or thousands of people. He's affected millions of lives by his work, his words, and his spirit. So, on behalf of the Center Theatre Group family, on behalf of the Center Theatre Group family and the Davidson family, I want to welcome you to a celebration of the life and career of Gordon Davidson. Ladies and gentlemen, Charlene Woodard.
Hey, everybody. I never said this to his face, but I've always felt like Gordon Davidson was my fairy godfather. I was in an off-Broadway theater years ago performing a student matinee of my first play, Pretty Fire. In an attempt to exercise diversity, the theater invited a few busloads of seven-year-old African-American children from Brooklyn. Now, Pretty Fire was about kids. It wasn't for kids. I was mortified. And during the show, you know, as Miles Davis played the trumpet, I'd say to the audience, "You hear that?" And then they responded that day, "Yes!" I was mortified, and halfway through the first act, I noticed a head full of white hair glowing in the dark. Oh, my goodness. Oh, my goodness. On this, of all days, surrounded by 70 seven-year-old girls, sat Gordon Davidson. Oh, my God, he came. He came. I'm, like, so happy, but then I was mortified. And after the debacle, of course, Gordon came backstage. You know I was in tears. Gordon talked me down. Eventually, we had a good laugh. And as he was leaving, I said, "I'm so sorry, Gordon." And he said, "Not to worry. You'll do this again." And 2 years later, at the same Off-Broadway theater, during a sold-out evening performance of my new play, with an audience of full audience of grown-ups, I saw the white hair glowing in the dark. Yay. And after the show, Gordon Davidson came to my crowded dressing room, and he leaned into me, and he asked so simply, "Would you like to do this at the taper?" He surrounded me with that brilliant taper family, which included Robert Egan, Corey Madden, Luis Alfaro, just to name a few. And my life in the theater changed forever. And so here's a bit of what Gordon heard that day when he was surrounded by 77-year-old girls. I was 5, and my little sister Allie was 4. And one Saturday, when Allie and I were watching old black and white movies, Mommy came into the living room and she turned off the television. She said, "Ladies, tell me, what would you like to be when you grow up?" "Me first, Mommy. Me first, please." "Mommy, I want to be Lassie." "Yes, Mommy. I want to be Lassie. I want to run through the field and jump over the fence and see the little girl trapped in the mines, and I will call for help. And everyone will come, and they will save the little girl trapped in the mines. And then they'll say, 'Oh, good girl, Lassie, good girl.' And Mommy, everyone will love me." And my mother said, now, Charlene, you don't have to be a dog to get love in this family." That's enough of that now. I done told you. Sit your butt down. Okay, come on, ladies. Tell Mommy. What kind of a human being would you like to be when you grow up? Second chance, Mommy, please, second chance. "Mommy, I want to be Shirley Temple." "I need to be Shirley Temple." "Oh, Mommy, I want to live in a big, white marble house with a huge spiral staircase that goes all the way up to heaven. And I will stand at the top of the staircase and right next to my happy Negro butler, all dressed up in tucks and tails and clean white gloves. And together, we will come tap dancing down that staircase. Shabba-dabba-da, shabba-dabba-da. I wish I was in the land of cotton. Old times there are not forgotten. Look away, shabba-dabba-dow. Look away, shabba-dabba-dow. Look away, shabba-dabba-dow. Dixieland, papa-dow. Hey!" And then my sister Allie said, "Mommy, my turn is next. My turn is next, please." And Mommy said, "Very good, Allie. Your turn is next. Charlene, sit down." And Allie said, "Mommy, I want to be the happy Negro maid, Mommy. I want to be in charge of everything, especially the big, wonderful kitchen with the 6-foot-long freezer like Granddaddy's. And I will thaw out all the turkeys and all the hams. And I will bake them up, Mommy, and I will serve them to the Colonel and to my sister, Shirley Temple. In Dixieland, I take my stand to live and die in Dixie." That's enough. That's enough of this Dixie stuff. You will not be Lassie. You will not be Shirley Temple. And you will not be a maid. Now, I want you both to go on out in the backyard and meditate on what I just said. Go on. Go on and play. Stop that barking. And Allie and I went way in the back of the backyard, and back of the peach tree where Mommy couldn't hear us, and we sang Dixie sottovoce. In Dixieland, I'll take my stand to live and die in Dixie. Thank you.
Good evening. I'm Zev Yaroslavsky. And some people still remember. First of all, I want to thank Judy and the Davidson family for asking me to say a few words about my constituent and my friend, Gordon Davidson. Webster's defines genius in a number of ways. Among them, a person considered as having strong influence over another, the personification of quality, a particular character or essential spirit or nature of a nation, place, or age, a great natural ability, a great mental capacity and inventive ability, especially great and original creative ability in some sort of art or science, and of course, any person with a very high intelligence quotient. By all of these definitions, Gordon Davidson was a genius, and for over four decades, Los Angeles was his workshop. When Gordon arrived here in 1964, Los Angeles wasn't considered much of a theater town. He didn't know us, and most of us didn't know him. In short order, he became artistic director of the Center Theater Group, and Los Angeles and the nation came to know him as the courageous genius he was. In 1967, Gordon opened the Mark Taper Forum with a bang, mounting a John Whiting play, The Devils, about sexual repression, mass religious hysteria, and political intrigue in a 17th century French convent. Then Governor Ronald Reagan walked out during intermission. The Catholic Church hated it. And my predecessors on the Los Angeles County Board of Supervisors, you can imagine what went through their mind. This board, which helps fund the Music Center, felt scandalized. Good thing there was no Twitter then. Gordon was on his way, and for the next 38 years, he never looked back. He set the artistic tone early with that production. It was no fluke or one-off stunt. For nearly four decades, guided by his vision and inspired by his passion and his imagination, the Taper and Gordon Center Theater Group were a hotbed of creativity, speaking truth to power, informing and educating audiences from national leaders and opinion leaders to hourly wage workers and young students. As a political activist myself, who came of age in the early years of Gordon's career here, I remember vividly how much his work spoke directly to the concerns of my generation. We grew up in the shadow of the bomb, and the Cuban Missile Crisis was only a few years behind us when Gordon presented In the Matter of J. Robert Oppenheimer, peering into the conscience of a leading architect of our atomic and nuclear arsenal. And there were others, so many others, Zoot Suit, which examined the troubled history of the city's race relations, revisiting the infamous Zoot Suit riots of the early 40s, in which white American sailors clashed violently with Mexican American youths over their supposedly unpatriotic flashy outfits. Chavez Ravine, performed on this stage by Culture, next door by Culture Clash, which explored one of the more despicable episodes in city history, and Water and Power, which explored the evolution and the coming of age of power in the Latino community. Tony Kushner's Angels in America, which was originally which was originally developed and workshopped right here at the Tabor under Gordon Davidson's supervision. It offered a unique and original historical, mystical, and spiritual exploration of gay life and the existential crisis of the AIDS epidemic. As an elected official representing a large gay constituency and directly responsible for ensuring adequate county health care, the play could not have been more relevant to me. And if anyone questions the relationship between policy and art, between politics and theater, I can say, I think confidently, that Angels in America probably influenced more policy in this country than any memo ever written by a bureaucrat or a policymaker. And there were so many others, but I'll stop. The best of theater is that which educates us and provokes us, causes us to question our own confidently held assumptions and beliefs. Gordon Davidson understood the great potential that theater offered to our society, and he didn't squander that opportunity for 1 minute during the 40 of the most important, productive, and meaningful years ever associated with one theater director. Gordon was my friend, but more than that, he was my teacher, one of my best, the kind whose lessons have stayed with me for a lifetime. Here in Los Angeles, we are blessed that we could call Gordon Davidson our own. We miss him, and we'll continue to miss him. But his legacy is alive and well in the words and scripts and productions which he curated during his career here. Those works are timeless gifts that will keep on giving to future generations. A genius has lived among us. He cannot be replaced, and he will not be forgotten. Thank you, Gordon Davidson.
Lucky enough, honored enough to be in the production that Gordon Davidson did of Ghetto in 1986. That was 30 years ago. That's me 30 years ago. I'm so glad you're sitting where you're sitting. So far away. That's good for me. Thank you. My favorite memory of working with Gordon Davidson was actually among the many memories of spending the time doing the show Ghetto, is the very first day that I met him, because that was when I auditioned. And I got the part on the spot. And you all know that never happens. Never, never, never. I sang, and I left the room, and I went out onto Grand Avenue with all those butterflies that you have when you've just sung a song for Gordon Davidson, and you're so aflutter because he's so damn handsome. And the next thing I knew, I heard footsteps behind me, footsteps, 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 and it was Gordon. And he was right behind me on the street. And he said, "What's your availability?" Oh my God, if I'd had a hat, I would have thrown it in the air like Mary Tyler Moore. All I can say is that from then on, during the many, many, many weeks of rehearsal and the many, many weeks of performances, that 101 became not a freeway, it became a road to such happiness. I've never enjoyed the 101 since, but it's okay, it was just great then. This is a song from Ghetto. The melody is an original melody from the Ghetto of Vilna during World War II. and the lyric was translated from the Yiddish by Jim Friedman. I wander the alleyways lost and distracted until I arrive at the wall. The weather is warm and the breezes are gentle, but I don't feel April at all. I stand there and listen to laughter and street sounds that come bubbling in from outside. Your face is before me wherever I go, and it's almost a year since I've cried. Springtime, where is my loved one? Why do the birds sing up there in the trees? Springtime, there's music in the flowers, but till I join you, I won't hear the melody. Ich blonde in ghetto von gesso zu gesso und kennet gefin in kein Ort. Nie to ist mein Lieber, wie trocht men arriba, Menschen o so zerwocht. Es leucht auf mein Heim, ist der Himmel der Bläue, wo je obi ist der Fun. Ich steh wie a Bettler bei jedwiden Teuer, la bise la Frühling, nimmst du mein Treuer und bring mein Liebst in mein Treuen zurück. Frühling, auf deine Flügel bleier und of my glee. I peer in dark waters, the face that's reflected is someone I no longer know. Wherever you are, be it earth or in heaven or hell, that's the place I will go. I wander the ghetto from alley to alley, my odyssey is practically through. But spring will be warm in the April of Aprils when I'm reunited with you. Springtime, where is my loved one?
My name is Michael Christopher, and I came to Los Angeles in 1972-73 as an unemployed actor. And the first job I got was at the Mark Taper Forum in a production of Sam Shepard's play, The Tooth of Crime. I played Crow, sort of a lethal rock star. Now, I don't remember who designed the costume, but it was, you can't see the, there were 10-inch platform shoes, heels, and the tights, and the Speedo, and a lot of glitter, and mascara knives, and lipstick, and this was my way of introducing myself to Los Angeles as an actor. Anyway, after one performance, and it was a very, very intense performance, I was in the dressing room. I was dripping wet sweat, and you know, the mascara was running, and the lipstick was smudged. And the door opened, and this man came bounding into the dressing room and said, "Hi, I'm Gordon Davidson." I said, "Oh, no, no." I said, "Well, there's the end of my career at this theater." I wanted to pull out my driver's license and say, "Look, I don't always look like this." But Gordon was smiling, you know, that smile of delight. And he had a look in his eye like, you know, like he was seeing something in me, you know, more than I was seeing in myself at the time. And that was our beginning. Not long after that, Gordon arranged a reading of a play that I had written. I think he saw more in that play than I saw in it myself. He ended up producing the play and directing it at the Taper. And then he fought like hell to get that play to the East Coast. Twisted arms, pulled favors. And he got it to the Long Wharf Theater in Connecticut. And then again, he fought like hell to get it into New York and onto Broadway. And we opened on Broadway, and we didn't do great business. Who wanted to see a play about people dying? And so Gordon fought like hell to keep the play running. And then out of the blue, we won the Pulitzer Prize, and we got a Tony nomination. So the producers were embarrassed. They couldn't close it now. They had to wait. And then we won the Tony. I didn't know what was happening. I was very young. I was very self-absorbed. I had an ego the size of the Grand Canyon. I didn't realize it then, but my life changed forever. Thanks to Gordon, I had a home at the Taper. I did acted in a dozen plays. Gordon produced three more of the plays I had written. He directed two of them and, again, got them to New York. One of them, I think, almost got him fired, but That's another story. Look, I have a wonderful life. You know, I live in a nice house. I have a partner of 28 years who we were just married last week. And and for 40 odd years, I have been able to write plays and get them produced. I've written screenplays, I've directed films. I'm still acting, I'm still doing all of those things. I wouldn't have any of this if it hadn't been for Gordon. So, it was a rocky relationship. I disappointed him often. We fought, we laughed when we had a hit, we cried when we missed. I like to think that there was some love in it, from him to me, from me to him. I don't know. I know there is now. There is love for him and gratitude. And I wanted to be here tonight to say all this out loud and to say thank you. Thank you, Gordon. Thank you.
Gordon at CTG, who began to change the way regional theaters thought about what they should be doing. And Gordon began to develop new work. He had a strong interest in work that was political, that was humanist, that was liberal, and started developing relationships with his audience, really, I think. He was one of the first artistic, well, he was so opposite to me. Gordon used to love post-play discussions. Do you remember that? You couldn't keep him off the stage after a play. He loved to talk to the audience about the plays. And created that, he was sort of also one of the first people to create that sort of family of subscribers, people who got to know him and know what he thought of plays. And he loved, didn't make any difference what an audience thought of the play. He wanted to hear it. He wanted to engage. And I think that was something certainly I couldn't and didn't want to repeat. I didn't like to talk to the audience after plays. But for Gordon, the play was the beginning of a dialogue. And that was both unusual and sort of unprecedented, I think, in the American theater. You know, we can talk about his effect on the theater, the world of theater, but I just miss him personally. He was such a sort of avuncular and intimate presence in my life. He had, you know, a lovely sense of humor would become sort of giddy at the idea of ideas in a play, I think. I miss his big head sort of leaning in to have an intimate conversation.
He was so lovely to me. And so genuine, and so authentic, and so kind. And I think that's just about every person I know who knew Gordon, that's their experience of him. He wasn't just a remarkable person of the theater. He was not just this person who had created theater in Los Angeles. He was a remarkable human being. And that's why I think everyone loved him. And that's why I think the work that he did in Los Angeles was such a success. It came from the heart and the passion and the love that Gordon had for the theater and for artists in the theater. And I think he changed the face of Los Angeles, not just by the theater, but by his person.
Gordon Davidson, who became a kind of a guardian angel for me and for so many other people. But, you know, when he read Angels, when he read Millennium Approaches and decided that he really wanted to be actively involved in furthering the project and making sure that it happened, and he was just extraordinarily supportive and kind and smart, and really helped me figure out how to handle the rather complicated path that the play took from its earliest stages to Broadway and helped me figure out which theater to go to, which organization to go to on Broadway. And Gordon was a really great friend and somebody I love very dearly. I can't imagine my career in the theater without him.
Hi, my name is Jonathan Lee, and I'm astonished to say this. Jeez. That is the first time that has ever happened. As one of the elders among the staff of Center Theater Group, I have been asked to share my thoughts about what it was like to serve as a staff member under Gordon. I've been the production manager at the Marte Perform for 28 years, but prior to that, I had the great good fortune to be hired as a stage manager for many plays at the Taper, including two plays that always seem to be listed near the top of Gordon's bio, Zoot Suit and Children of a Lesser God. I stage managed Children at the Taper and then again on Broadway, and he also tapped me to direct the bus and truck production of Children while he was busy directing the show in London. So I brought a prop with me. It is a commemorative t-shirt that was printed about 20 years ago. I decided not to actually wear the 20-year-old t-shirt, but here it is. Like Gordon, I hold on to everything. The back of the shirt honors our legendary technical director, Bobby Rotolo, who sadly passed away just a little over a year ago. It says in huge letters, "Where the hell is Gus?" Gus was our driver that Bobby would send out on errands, and then he'd disappear, so at least once a day when we were loading in the set, Bobby would say, "Where the hell is Gus?" But the message on the front of the shirt honors Gordon. In smaller letters, it says, "How can this have happened?" That's a phrase that Gordon would use whenever some unpleasant surprise or disappointment would come up. If a prop was the wrong color, or a costume wouldn't fit, or the giant moving wall in Angels in America got stuck so the angel couldn't make her entrance, Gordon would come to us afterwards with a sort of quizzical expression. He'd purse his lips, he'd lower his eyebrows, he'd tilt his head a little bit to one side, and he'd ask, "How could this have happened?" Of course, on a certain level, that question was code for "you screwed up." But Gordon really was interested in the answer, and more to the point, he wanted us to be interested in the answer. He depended on us to anticipate him, and he wanted us to feel the same ownership and responsibility and passion as he did for everything that we touched on the stage. The morning that I learned that we lost Gordon, the first thought that passed through my mind was, "How can this have happened?" And then I felt the unlikely combination of exasperation, awe, and genuine affection that those words evoke for me as I remember him. One would think, running an organization the size of Center Theatre Group, that its leader would figure out how to concentrate on what was important and delegate what was not, but not Gordon. To Gordon, all of it was important. So he compelled himself to monitor and control the minutest details of CTG's operation. This was a blessing and a curse. I was once told about how upset Gordon was that a press release went out without his knowledge. The staff member said, "But Gordon, we showed this to you." To which he responded, "I know you showed it to me, but I didn't see it." He was there with us for every night for notes after previews. We would hold production meetings in his office, sitting cross-legged on the floor and spreading out plans on his coffee table, which was already covered with scripts and programs and piles of those pink "while you were out" slips, phone message slips. He seemed to have thousands of those pink slips. I often wondered how we would ever find time to call all those people back. Once a card made it into Gordon's Rolodex, it never left. Not if the person moved. The new address would go on top of the old one. And if you were unfortunate enough to pass away, you lived on in the Rolodex. Gordon rarely fired staff members. There was a certain kind of person who tended to thrive in the environment that he created. I was one of those people who don't mind working in a tumultuous landscape of shifting possibilities where decisions are postponed until long, long, long after the last rational moment to decide has passed. People who didn't like working that way would simply fire themselves. But his belief in the importance of what we were doing, his optimism that we could pull it off under what would seem to a normal person like impossible circumstances, was inspiring to those of us who stayed by his side. Gordon had two dress modes. As artistic director, he would wear a jacket and tie, but when he was directing a play, he would always come to rehearsal in jeans and a sweatshirt, as if he was planning to do yard work. And that's how he directed. He was making our garden grow. He was creating an environment where artists could flourish, but feeding, digging, pruning their work so that what emerged was a thing of beauty with shape and meaning. For Gordon, every play had an arc, and it was his quest to find it. One of the best examples of his genius for storytelling was Children of a Lesser God. It was the 1979-80 season. I was hired as a stage manager for a taper show, not children. But a little over a month before rehearsals were supposed to begin, the show dropped out, and Gordon had to come up with a quick substitution. And there was this play by Mark Medoff that he'd seen in a workshop version. It was still very rough, didn't really have a second act, but Gordon saw its potential and decided to direct it. He actually believed that John Rubinstein, whom he cast in the male leading role, would be able to learn to perform an entire play in American Sign Language in a month. No rational person would believe that. But Gordon did, and John Rubinstein did it. But there was that problem of the second act. Gordon worked tirelessly with Medoff to shape the play, but it still wasn't there even after we began rehearsals. I remember one particularly intense session with Gordon, John, the inimitable Phyllis Frelich, and Mark Medoff sitting around the table. Gordon gave a passionate speech to Mark, brimful of ideas about how to restructure the scene order of the second act. When Gordon finished, Mark turned to me and asked, "Did you get that?" Fortunately, I had. Maybe I was just avoiding another how could this have happened moment. And eventually, Gordon's ideas about the shape of that play turned Children of a Lesser God into a multi-Tony Award-winning production. Best actor for John, best actress for Phyllis, best play for Mark. But unimaginably, no Tony Award for Gordon, who made that production and its success possible. And so he moved on to the next project and the next. To this day, I still cannot imagine where all of his energy came from. Vivian Eliff, Gordon's executive assistant for many years, referred to him affectionately, although probably not to his face, as the maniac. She would be grateful for those moments of respite when he was on an airplane and couldn't call her. And then they put phones on airplanes. There was no escape. But we all put up with it because he inspired us to share his almost mystical faith in the power of theater. Gordon always believed that every word that was spoken, every gesture, every performance stayed in these buildings long after the show was over. When we did the renovation of the Taper 10 years ago, Gordon was very concerned, and I think he truly believed this, that if we cut holes in the roof, some of those words would escape. But I don't think they have. They're all still there at the Taper. They're still here at the Ahmanson. I'll admit, Gordon made me nervous. I was always on edge that he would throw something at me that I might not be able to handle. And by that, I mean a task, not an actual object. But he kept throwing things at me because he believed in me. One of the highest compliments that Gordon could pay you was to give you more responsibility. And I'm incredibly grateful for his trust, his guidance, his leadership, his passion, and he'll be with me forever, as will this t-shirt.
Good evening, everyone. I'm Harry Groner, and I'm very proud and honored, thank you, to be here tonight. Thank you, Judy. I know it's in your program, but this is Shelley Markham, ladies and gentlemen, playing on the piano. I think I can say this, at least I hope I can. Gordon and I were friends. I know we were colleagues, and when we worked together, I never felt like an actor just taking direction. Gordon made you feel like you were collaborating with him. I love Gordon, and I love the way he loved the theater, everything about it. Aside from his family, I don't think there's anything that made him happier. And I don't know about the business part of it. I don't know any artistic director who loves the endless meetings and countless fundraising events, but he loved being in that room, the rehearsal room, the room where, if you're lucky, wonderful things happen. Wonderful, scary, and sometimes very dangerous things happened in 1986 when we worked on Ghetto by Joshua Sobel. It was one of the most intense and profound experiences of my career. And for Gordon as well, I think. I know it had a powerful effect on the audience as well, and Gordon made that happen. The play is based on a true story about the performers in the Vilna ghetto in Lithuania in World War II, trying to keep hope alive through theater and music. I played the SS officer, Hans Kittel, in charge of the ghetto. Now, he was a real person, and he fancied himself an artist as well, and felt in some sick way that he was one of them, the Jewish performers he was sending to the camps. In order for us to feel free enough to work on this play that forced you to go to some very, very dark places, Gordon created a safe room. He was gentle, he was patient, protective, understanding, and he was brilliant. He made it possible for us to explore what it feels like to be terrorized, to have no power, to be at the mercy of one man, and there was never any mercy from Hans Kittel. I was given the freedom, not just by Gordon, but because of Gordon, by the cast as well, to explore what absolute power felt like, what the seduction of evil felt like. It was the first and only time so far that I had nightmares about a play. To say the play was difficult to watch is an understatement, but I don't remember anyone in the audience walking out. They remained spellbound, fascinated, even knowing the inevitable outcome. It was one of those plays that became bigger than the actors and the audience experiencing the story. Andrea Markovici played the chanteuse in the play, and she sang most of the songs. One song in particular became a kind of anthem for those suffering in the ghetto, and not just in the Vilna ghetto, but in the other ghettos and camps as well, and it symbolized their unity and solidarity. On more than one occasion, when Andrea started to sing this song, you could see in the audience, in the taper audience, individuals standing. One here, two over there, another over there. And on one night, in the front row, right in front of Andrea, a man started to get up. His wife pulled at his sleeve to get him to sit back down, but he wouldn't sit. He stood there, proud, defiant. Well, when you saw that, the tears just shot out of your eyes. It was stunning. It was heartbreaking. And many of the actors on stage found it very difficult to get through that song. I tell you this because it was Gordon that made that happen. I will be eternally grateful to Gordon for giving me the gift of that experience. I will treasure it and never, ever forget it. Now, here's something that some of you might not know about Gordon. In 1989, Kenneth Branagh came to the taper with his Renaissance Theater Company with productions of Midsummer Night's Dream and King Lear. Now, Gordon was very impressed with the company and lamented the fact that actors in LA would probably never commit to a company the way Kenneth's company did, because, as we all know, you come here for TV and film and not theater. Well, Dakin Matthews and Lillian Garrett Grogue didn't believe that, so they picked up the gauntlet And they said, sure we can. After a few months of talking to as many actors in the community as possible and asking the question, so what do you think? Is it possible? They gathered 36 actors to start this company. Gordon, and God bless him for this, said, okay, here's what I'll do. I will give you the annex, all three rehearsal rooms on Monday night when the taper is dark. You can have use of the copy machines and anything else you need. Go for it. Start your company. The 36 quickly grew to 50 by the end of the first year, and we all showed up faithfully every Monday night for about 5 years and started the Antaeus Company. Gordon did that. He gave us that boost up, the first step, our first home to begin our journey, and after 25 years, we're still going strong. Thank you, Gordon Davidson. I love Gordon, and I will miss him. I will always remember his spirit, his kindness, his enthusiasm, his laugh that made his eyes disappear. And I am very, very proud and honored to be able to say, Gordon and I were friends. This is for Judy and for Gordon. The way you wear your hat, the way you sip your tea, the memory of all that. No, no, they can't take that away from me. The way your smile just beams, the way you sing off key, the way you haunt my dreams. No, no, they can't take that. Never meet again on that bumpy road to love. Still, I'll always, always keep the memory of the way you hold your knife, the way we danced till three, the way you changed my life. No, no, they can't take that. Can't take that away. They can't take that away. They can't take that away from me.
Wondering what they're doing, they're placing a step here so I don't disappear. It seems all of Gordon's other collaborators are tall. I am Tom Moore. I'm a director. Thank you. And hopefully tonight I represent many whose career was profoundly influenced by Gordon Davidson and these theaters. Many years ago, when these theaters and I were very young and just out of Yale School of Drama, I left a very cold and wintry New York to fly to California for the very first time to interview as an assistant director for the young, just becoming famous, sometimes infamous, Gordon Davidson, and to serve as associate director of a journeyman program of young actors. As I walked across the Music Center Plaza, where there was no computerized fountain, where the Lipschitz sculpture was yet to be installed, I passed the Mark Taper Forum, still surrounded on all sides by reflecting pools. And there was a poster, because the theater was presenting Gordon's production of the controversial in the matter of J. Robert Oppenheimer, which Zev Yaroslavsky talked about. It had just made national news across the country. I was thrilled, I was very nervous and excited, as something very important seemed to be happening here. I quickly realized under that warm, sunny sky that Los Angeles would soon be my permanent home. But what I didn't know that day was that I was also about to meet a man who would become a mentor, an artistic collaborator, and a very close friend. It's hard to remember now, but those were the early years of the birth of the resident theater movement in the US. There were only a few artistic directors forging theaters uniquely their own. The now legendary figures like Zelda Fitchhandler at the Arena, Tyrone Guthrie at the Guthrie in Minneapolis, William Ball at the American Conservatory Theater in San Francisco, and of course, Gordon at the Mark Taper Forum. These giants were visionaries, courageous and bold, creating something that had never been tried before. They were transforming the American theater. Zelda Fitchhandler, who Gordon admired as best among best, described creating a theater this way. "We forged a better way. We scratched it out, hacked it, ripped it, tore it, yanked it, clawed it out of the resisting, unyielding, nose-thumbing environment. Nobody called us, but we came." These were major achievements that would have an incredible and lasting impact on the American theater. And all of us are incredibly indebted for their accomplishments. Out of that group, and in one of the least likely places for theater to flourish, Gordon was the only one focusing primarily on new and mostly political plays. The stories of the opening theater were legend, and you've heard some of those. The fact that the Board of Supervisors was very concerned, the fact that the Cardinal was deeply concerned because it was a communist plot, and you've heard about Ronald Reagan. There were threats of blackmail and disaster, but Lou Wasserman, head of the CTG board, and the indomitable Buffy Chandler stood up to them all, and the devil, CTG, and Gordon moved ahead. But this is something you probably don't know. There were still challenges. There was a later attempt by the politicians to create a standards committee to oversee all future productions at Center Theatre Group. Franklin Murphy, former chancellor of UCLA, was appointed chairman. At the first meeting, he called it to order, then quickly announced that it was the first and the last meeting of the standards committee. I mention these pieces of CT history because, one, Gordon, scared as he might have been at the time, courageously stood his ground. And because of who Gordon was, all of these major movers and shakers of Los Angeles believed in him and supported him by allowing the creation of something extraordinary. So instead of closing a theater, a galvanized Los Angeles gained a major theater of politics and ideas, which Gordon, as you know, led for over 35 years. I also mention these moments of CTG history, as there is an eerie similarity of that history to our present political situation. And Gordon would have very much wanted to be at the forefront of having that fight. Although I got the job that magical sunny California day, I wouldn't say it turned out all that well, as I, quite frankly, was a terrible assistant, which Gordon, by the way, very gently but firmly confirmed. And the journeyman program, for which I was associate director, was canceled at the end of that first season. So, somewhat of a failure, I went back to New York to start making a career. But what was started in that meeting was a bond that was going to last throughout our lives and became one of the most important of my life. In later years, Gordon and I did many productions together here. The first was Division Street, and the last was Royal Family. And CTG, for many, many years, happily became my theatrical home. I loved collaborating with Gordon because when he would watch rehearsals and give notes, those notes would always be not about how he would do the play, but how to help you in your effort to reach your vision and how to best serve the play. And he would relentlessly never let you give up on reaching for the best and exploring every last possibility in the production, sometimes to my exhausted dismay. And yes, it is true, he would sometimes doze for a minute or two at a run-through. But I always took this as an omen that something at that moment was definitely not holding the audience's attention. And I did my best to fix it. Opening nights were special moments into themselves. Gordon cherished his theater family and the idea of community, of all kinds. And that idea of community was never far from his mind. In those early days, it was financially possible for CTG to have two opening nights. The first was for the theatrical community, and the second was for the critics. In this great, sprawling city of ours, Gordon made it possible for our community to have our very own church social. These were marvelous nights as we caught up with all of those we had worked with, all of those we would love to work with, and all of those who we just admired. Overseeing it all was the great welcomer-in-chief, shaking hands, making introductions, and ensuring that everyone was having a grand time. The memory of him greeting everyone in the lobby of these theaters is indelible. His energy and his affection were boundless, and he had an enormous gift and warmth that made each of us feel special. Over the years, I would watch Gordon and his ease in social situations, and especially his easy way with names. Until one day, I'd noticed that he seemed to know everyone's names, primarily because the amazing Judy Davidson was always by his side. By his side, on his side, always. A remarkable partnership. I would marvel at his profound love of family for Judy, Adam, and Rachel, and of course, eventually, for his beloved grandchildren. And I was impressed with how he identified with his religion and how it supported him in his work and life. But what always left me speechless and in awe was his unwavering passion for the theater, for the art of storytelling and for the artists who brought those stories to life, and his absolute and unyielding belief that the theater was the supreme art form for exploring the big ideas of our time. When many of us would grow weary or jaded or fatalistic, Gordon continued to believe and believe and believe. In these last 10 years since Gordon retired from CTG, I don't think anyone would be surprised to know that Gordon missed his beloved directing. But when that didn't happen, he never gave up on what he spent his life creating, and he never gave up his passion for any of it, continuing to support his theatrical community right up until the very end. What Gordon did for me in giving me a place at the table, he did for thousands of others with unfailing generosity and kindness, and his legacy for Los Angeles and the entire American theater is quite astounding in its breadth and accomplishment. Gordon will have influenced not only those of us who had the good fortune to know him and to work in his theater, but for generations to come. Arthur Miller once said, "I cannot imagine a theater worth my time that doesn't want to change the world." And aren't all of us the lucky ones to have been present at the creation as Gordon did his best to change our world. Thank you.
Gordon Davidson hired me away from being a theater critic at the LA Herald Examiner I have never understood why he was generous enough to do that. I was not a particularly charitable critic toward the Taper, or toward his work at the Taper, even. And I took pot shots at some of the work that he did. But he was apparently convinced that there was something there that could be helpful to him if it were on the inside rather than the outside. And he gave me the freedom to be an idiot and to not know what I was talking about and to nurture me along until I knew more about what I needed to know. And he was, you know, he was a great father figure to, I think, everyone at the Taper, with all of the positives and negatives that having a father figure mean. And I always felt like I was in a protected atmosphere, that I was in a family atmosphere, and that the family would catch me if I fell, and would applaud me if I succeeded. And that was I was 3,000 miles away from my real family, which lived in New York. That was a wonderful way to grow up into a professional world.
In thinking about Gordon and my 20 years with Gordon in this building, there's one story that comes to mind. That was, we were doing a play in here called Made in Bangkok by the great Anthony Minghella, who has since died. And we were sitting up in the back row, as we always did for first preview. And something had happened backstage, so I had to go backstage. And then I came out just as the lights were coming up at the beginning of the show. So normally, sitting in the back row with Gordon for first previews, for several reasons, it would be usually the playwright, and I would sit between the playwright and Gordon in case Gordon nodded off during the show, so the playwright didn't see it. But when I came back into the theater, it was Anthony, Gordon, and I was sitting on the other side. And the beginning of the show was a 747 sound cue, landed on the stage really loud, and then the play began. And about three lines into the play, Gordon fell asleep, and fell asleep, not nodding down, but he fell asleep onto Anthony Minghella. And it remained that way through the first act, and the lights came up for intermission, and Gordon awoke, and he turned to Anthony and myself, and he said, "That was a great first act. I just have one note. In the third scene, Jamie Cromwell and Zoe Wanamaker have this moment. It can be deeper and better observed by you, Bob, and maybe, Anthony, you want to look at the writing in that section." And then he got up and left. And Anthony turned to me and said, "My God, that man is fucking miraculous. He has a third eye that he can see the stage even when he's sound asleep." And I think that is true about Gordon. He did have a third eye, a sacred eye, that saw deeply into the work and led to an enormous heart. Gordon Davidson had the biggest heart in the American theater.
My favorite Gordon Davidson story, in terms of working with him as a director, we were doing a very difficult play by Michael Christopher, which he wrote after The Shadow Box and after he'd won the big prizes, you know, and called Black Angel, The Black Angel, and Joe Mahar, God help me. Gordon said to me one day, just enraged, this is a play about a Nazi war criminal and his wife. And he said to me, "Will you quit judging this character and just play her?" And that was wonderful. I've used it ever since. Not my job to have an opinion about who I'm playing, just play her. That's a gift, that's a big gift, lasting. If you can get one thing, you know.
Hi. I'm Luis Valdez. As an American playwright for over the last 50 years, it has been my mission to sing the song of America. It is my privilege this evening to sing the song of Gordon Davidson. My friend, a mentor, a colleague, a collaborator, and certainly one of the great souls of the American theater. 40 years ago, almost exactly 40 years ago, he invited me into his office here at the Taper because he had a project that he wanted me to know about. He had a series called The New Theater for Now, and he was engaging local playwrights, California playwrights especially, to come and record the history of Los Angeles. And so we sat in his office and very quickly arrived at a common thought about the Pachucos, the Zoot Shooters, and the Zoot Suit Riots. He felt the urgency of it. He felt its connection to the pulse, not just of Los Angeles, but of the nation. And so he commissioned me to write a play about these events, the Sleepy Lagoon murder case of 1942 and the Zoot Suit Riots of 1943. Little did I know the extents to which this play would reach, not just as a work of theater, but as a work of public consciousness, as a work of the American narrative, which these days is severely threatened by forces of darkness and ignorance and racial discrimination. Gordon had actually become aware of my work with El Teatro Campesino, the Farm Workers Theater, 4 years before. Peter Brook came to San Juan Bautista, the headquarters of El Teatro Campesino, and Gordon was there, and he became aware that this ragtag group called the Farm Workers Theater was engaged in some very basic, very simple, but very essential stuff. And so he invited El Teatro Campesino to come to the Mark Taper Forum and perform for 4 nights over a weekend. And we sold out every house. It was our signature piece from the 70s, La Gran Carpa de los Rascuaches. It was in Spanish and in English. He didn't care because he made a home for us. He opened the doors. And so 3 years later, he invited me then as a playwright and as an individual to address the issue of history in Los Angeles, and it was my privilege to be able to do that because this is a theme, the idea of the Pachucos that had been haunting me all my life. And I have stated before in the LA Times that that transfer from El Teatro Campesino, having been in the fields, even the piece that we performed here had been performed in Texas in public parks in which the lights were the cars of people that came and turned on their lights at night so that we could perform. This is the raw theater. But he invited us to the Mark Taper Forum and suddenly we were on a very different scale. El Teatro Campesino and Chicano Theater became American theater. We had no idea that it would hit the pulse. We had a suspicion, but it hit the pulse of Los Angeles. This city is an incredible cauldron, a crucible of American thought and ideas. It is the revancha, it is the throwback. The westward movement of the 19th century brought people from all over the world to Los Angeles. The 20th century began the opposite direction from west to east. And that allowed then Chicanos and Filipinos and Asian Americans, Japanese Americans, and Chinese Americans to finally express their presence, their Statue of Liberty, even though we have no statue, you know. But in that sense, then, the Mark Taper Forum became a crucible for all Americans of color. When Zoot Suit opened on the poster, it said the New American Theater. And I continue to believe in that New American Theater. I believe in the New American audience, which must come in all colors, in all shades, in all backgrounds. And that is the national narrative that we must fight for. That is the national narrative that the life of Gordon Davidson represents, because he opened the doors not just to Chicanos, but to everybody. This was the Center Theater Group at the Music Center. And although this was Bunker Hill at one time, and the Pachucos actually hung out here in the Temple of La Temple y La Grande, you know, they used to hang out here, and these were homes and tenements. Nevertheless, I believe that the creation of the Music Center and the creation of the Mark Taper Forum has given Los Angeles, you know, a cherry on top of the cake. You know, it opened up, it focused everything. And so it was my privilege to come here with a play. And it was my honor to work with Gordonson because he was such a mentor. And you've heard it this evening, but in my case, it was real because we got into the play and got into enormous history, depth of field, you know, of people and of feelings and of music, the music of Lalo Guerrero, you know, became part. We weren't setting out to write a musical. We were documenting a period. But he was open to that. Sure, let's go for it. He went, he was bilingual, he was open to our bilingualism, and not just Spanish, but the Pachuco Patois. Órale, vato, no te agüites, carnal. Pues aquí estamos, carnal. And that was what used to be spoken, but he didn't mind that we put it on the stage. You know, in many ways, the Chicano theater is like the Yiddish theater. We are now part of American theater, and we are bringing the best that we can offer from our community into the mainstream. And because of Gordon, this was possible. I knew this then, I knew this 40 years ago when we began to work on Zoot Suit, and I know it now, because Zoot Suit is back. Zoot Suit will open at the Mark Taper Forum on February 12th, and it is a tribute to the spirit and memory of Gordon Davidson that the play is still alive. You know, about 15 years ago, he had a conversation with me. You want to bring Zoot Suit back and you can rework it? And at the time, I was just too busy to say, rework it, it's done, man. I can, you know. But you know, he was right. Zoot Suit has continued to evolve, and even now in rehearsal, we're making little changes, little tight squeezes. You know, the kind of work that he used to do on stage with actors, that spirit of Gordon Davidson lives today in the rehearsal room of the Mark Taper Forum. And so it is with deep, deep humility that I celebrate the spirit of Gordon Davidson, one of the great, great, greats of the American theater. I leave you with a little poem, because it is painful that he is no longer on earth, but his spirit survives. And yet this feeling, the poignancy of loss, is preserved in the Aztec poetry, you know. Anochipatlaltikpak sanachika yetnikan, I'll say it in Spanish. No para siempre en la tierra, solo un poco aquí. Aunque sea jade se quiebra, aunque sea oro se rompe, aunque sea plumaje de quetzal se desgarra. No para siempre en la tierra, solo un poco aquí. Not forever on this earth, just a brief moment here. Though it be jade, it is broken. Though it is gold, it will melt. Though it is a plumage of quetzal feathers, it will become ragged. Not forever on this earth. Yes, the flesh melts, the bones crumble, but the spirit lives forever. Gordon Davidson, the spirit of American theater. I salute you, my brother. Que viva Gordon Davidson! Orale.
I guess we're the young guys tonight. As a Chicano actor, I am honored and thrilled to be on the set of Amelie. Diversity has always been important to Gordon and to Michael, and I thank them both. More than 15 years ago, Gordon Davidson stood on the plaza just above us here, looking at Culture Clash and asking us, who the hell are you guys? As we gathered around, he pointed slightly north to the lights of Dodger Stadium, and he told us about a once unique barrio in the hills of Chavez Ravine. Find the story of that neighborhood, he said, and you will find the story of Los Angeles itself, my friends. And we found three neighborhoods nestled up the ravine, Palo Verde, Bishop, and La Loma, just a hill or two away from where we stood with Gordon on Bunker Hill. Standing there with the big fella, the Department of Water and Power there, the Dorothy Chandler there, Disney Hall just behind, the Kenneth Hahn Hall of Administration, the center of the universe there, the federal courtroom, the LA Times, and the Cathedral of Our Lady of Angels, where Walter O'Malley lay himself, the very crucible of LA power, as Luis noted, cradled here in the plaza. Yet Gordon wanted us to understand the neighborhood over there as it related to the power here in the plaza. Public housing, communism, Chicanos, Jews, baseball, Americans, the roots of progressive movements. Get underneath it, he instructed us. Get us right. Get it right, he said. Do not romanticize the poor people. Tell the truth, do the work. Years later, thanks to his guidance, his intelligence, his devotion, his mastery as a dramaturg, as a dramatist, and with over 3,000 notes,
given with love and warmth, we may have gotten Chavez Ravine right. And so, once again, tonight, for Gordon, we say, it's time for Dodger baseball. Hello, everybody, and a pleasant good afternoon to you, wherever you may be. Welcome to winter baseball at Dodger Stadium. Vin Scully here on a perfect Southern California night. Well, the sun has disappeared behind a moody canopy of heavy clouds for a parched state, thank goodness. But let me tell you, the ballpark never looked prettier, resplendent in Dodger blue. Today's broadcast brought to you by Farmer John Meat Products, the only Southern California packers of Iowa corn-fed pork. Oh, Farmer John, the way ham ought to be, Western style. Hey, Mom, next time try the new kosher cuts. Just tell the kids Sandy eats Farmer John on Friday nights. Tonight, for the first 40,000 Mark Taper Forum fans, you're going to receive a very limited special edition of the Flash Gordy bobblehead doll. Flash Gordon, the Lord of the Flatbush. There he is, a true blue Brooklyn Bums fan in Ebbetsfield. The bobblehead features young Flash at the age of 10, already with the shock of white hair, a friendly smile, a gentle manner, and when you shake his bobblehead, it seems to say, meh. Hey, Gordon, how was the theater production last night? Meh. It comes complete with a Bertolt Brecht handbook in his right vest pocket there. And of course, as soon as you perform your soliloquy or monologue, the bobblehead soon falls asleep. Yes. And next season, don't miss our special Luis Valdez bobblehead night. With a Zapata mustache giving off a fine air of machismo and a little sombrero you can toss from the cholo section. Don't forget. And on opening day, we'll have a very patriotic Donald Trump doll. Shake the Donald Trump doll and watch the country go to hell. In fact, it'd be really nice to hear Vin Scully say, fuck, that's never gonna happen. Sorry, I know there's children in the audience tonight. Vin would never drop the F-bomb, no. But tonight, we honor Gordon one final time with a time-honored tradition. Ladies and gentlemen, to help us send him off, our good friends Bud Abbott and Lou Costello. Say hello to Bud and Lou, everybody. Come on out, boys.
Well, Costello, you know, Walter Malley just asked me to coach the Los Angeles Dodgers.
Look, Abbott, if you're the new coach, you must know all the players.
I certainly do.
Well, I never met the guys, so you're going to have to tell me their names, and I'll know which players are on the team.
Let's see who we have on the bags. Who's on first, what's on second, I don't know who's on third.
Well, that's what I'm trying to find out.
I said, who's on first, what's on second, I don't know who's on third.
Look, if you're the new coach, you must know all the fellas' names.
Well, I should.
Well, then who's on first?
Yes.
I mean the fellas' name.
Who?
The guy playing first.
Who?
The first baseman.
Yes.
The first baseman. I'm asking you who.
That's the man's name.
That's whose name?
Yes.
So go ahead and tell me.
That's it.
That's who?
Yes.
Look, you have a first baseman. Who's playing first?
Yes. Who?
The guy playing first.
Who's on first?
I'm asking you who's on first.
That's the man's name.
Well, that's whose name?
Yes.
Look, when you pay the first baseman every month, who gets the money?
Who?
All I'm trying to find out is the player's name on first base.
Who?
The guy who gets the money.
Every dollar of it. Sometimes his wife comes and picks it up.
Whose wife?
Yes, what's wrong with that?
All I'm trying to find out, all I want to know is when you sign up the first baseman, how does he sign his name on the contract?
Who?
The guy, how does he sign his name?
Who? That's how he signs it.
Who?
Yes.
All I'm trying to find out is what's the player's name on first base?
No, what's on second base?
I'm not asking you who's on second.
Who's on first?
I don't know.
What'd you say?
I said I don't know.
He's on third base.
I'm not talking about third base.
Take it easy, Lou.
Yo solo quiero saber quién está en primera.
¿Quién?
¿Quién está en primera base?
Sí.
¿En la primera base?
¿Quién? Te estoy diciendo quién juega en primera.
Y yo no sé cómo se llaman de primera.
No, no, no. ¿Cómo está en segunda?
¿Y por qué estamos hablando en español?
I don't know. Why are we speaking in Spanish?
Yo no sé.
Third base!
Tony,
There he got it.
Which, Antonio Villaraigosa, how are you, Antonio?
I got your bobblehead.
Judy, listen, we just had to say, give our love, of course, to you and the family. You and Gordon had me over for a dinner party one night. I was out of my element. It was like a Woody Allen movie. I felt a little bit like Alan Alda. There was so many socialists there that night. It was really thrilling for me. Oscar Eustace once took us into Gordon's office and said, the Bolsheviks are here. And shut the door. That was Oscar. But I told Gordon that night, and he said, but I told Gordon that in our 33 years of travel, that I had found three yarmulkes on the streets of America. I found one on 42nd Street, the old 42nd Street, because we're doing a play at Intar in the old 42nd, and one on the Lower East Side at right outside the Public, and then I found one at a taqueria on Fairfax.
Who knew?
And they're round like a sombrero, so we can't really mess this up. And we know we didn't have the honor of sitting Shiva, and that's what not tonight is not about that. Well, we honor and respect that. But we will exit the stage in honor of dear Uncle Gordon wearing our yarmulkes, and just simply to tell you that we love you very much.
Shalom!
Shalom!
Greetings, greetings. My name is Keith David, and I'm so happy that we are here celebrating the same guy, the same wonderful guy. You know, when I was a young actor in New York and thinking about making my move to Los Angeles, well, having begun at the Public, I was looking for someplace maybe like that. Now, the Taper had been legendary, and so was Gordon Davidson. I'd only heard great things, and the prospect of possibly working here was one of those aspirations I dreamt about, hoped for, but didn't know if it would ever happen. Gordon was a name that was synonymous with the great man of the theater, a director who understood the process. He was one of those shiny men who, if you were an actor, a director, or a playwright, would help show you the way. Now, I met Gordon in the late 80s while he was nurturing playwright-director George Wolfe on a project to this day is some of the best fun I've ever had in my life and one of the best characters of my career. It was the Chimney Man in Jelly's Last Jam. And thank you. And after workshopping it for 3 years, we took it to Broadway in 92. Then in 96, I got to come back on another project that remains a red letter in my life, Seven Guitars, where I got the blessing to work with two other great men that can only be described as legendary, Lloyd Richards and August Wilson. Now, in August, never have I had the privilege of speaking such great poetic words expressing the human experience since Shakespeare. And in Lloyd and Gordon as director and producer, never have I experienced two men who understood the process. And as an actor, it was just a gift working with them. They were teachers and nurturers. Now, that being said, as someone else has said, the other thing that I experienced with Gordon was just, he was just one of the nicest men I ever met in my life. Now, outside of the theater, we'd see each other every once in a while. And he simply would say, hey, man, how you doing? And, you know, we might talk about what we were doing work-wise, and we might not. Once he came to see me in a play I was doing in New York, I hadn't expected him. He just showed up backstage, and he took me to dinner. And I don't remember talking about the play at all, because it actually wasn't very good, and we both knew that, and there was nothing very much to talk about. But he was gracious enough to know that and acknowledge that by not talking about it. He asked me what else I was doing in my life, and he let the rest go. To me, he was a real, real gentleman, a man who, frankly, I'd like to be more like, and I will miss him. Now, here are some of August's words that bring Gordon to mind. He was just a man I seen on the road. He ain't had no special look, just a man walking toward me on the road. He come up and asked me which way the road went. I told him everything I knew about the road, where it went and all, and he asked me if I had anything to eat, because he was hungry. Said he ain't had nothing to eat in 3 days. Well, I ain't never come out on the road without a piece of dried meat, an orange, or an apple, so I get a set of an orange, and he'd take and eat that orange. And he told me to come and go along the road a little ways with him, that he had something he wanted to show me. Now, he had a look about him that made me want to go with him to see what he had to show me. See, he had a voice inside him telling him which way to go, and if I come and go along with him, he was going to show me the secret of life. Now, quite naturally, I followed him. A fellow's going to show you the secret of life ain't to be taken lightly. Now, we get near this bend in the road, turn around that bend, and everything looked like it was twice as big as it was. The trees and everything, bigger than life, sparrows big as eagles. I turned and I looked at this fella, and he had this light coming out of him. I had to cover up my eyes to keep from being blinded. He's shining like new money with that light. He shined until all the light seemed to just seep out of him. And then he was gone. And I was by myself in this strange place where everything was bigger than life. I wandered around there looking for that road, trying to find my way back from this big place. And I looked over, and I see my daddy standing there. Now, my daddy, he called me to him, said he had been thinking about me, and it grieved him to see me in the world carrying other people's songs and not having one of my own. Told me he was going to show me how to find my song. Then he carried me further into this big place until we come to this ocean. Then he showed me something I ain't got words to tell you. But if you stand to witness it, well, you done seen something now. I stayed in that place a while, and my daddy taught me the meaning of this thing that I had seen. And he showed me how to find my song. I asked him about the shiny man, and he told me he was the one who goes before and shows the way. Said there are lots of shiny men, and if you ever saw one again before I died, then I'd know that my song had been accepted and worked its full power in the world. And I could lay down and die a happy man. A man who's done left his mark on life.
Good evening, everyone. Hi. My name is Luis Alfaro. I'm the other Luis. It's nice to see you. I grew up here. Many of you know that I grew up in downtown Los Angeles at Pico and Union. And as I was sort of getting ready for tonight, I had to retrace my steps. The first play I saw here was called The Shadow Box. I didn't fully understand it. I was too young, I think. But I was really smitten with the theater. And the next play I came back to see was called For Colored Girls. And the third play I saw was Zoot Suit. And then I had to work here, so I was an usher here for a very long time. So there's a lot of my usher family here. And then the 80s, I came back and performed a little here. And then the 90s, I spent 10 years here working under Gordon, first as part of the Latino Theater Initiative with Diane Rodriguez, and then as part of New Play Development. And in fact, this stage, I've only been on it once. I helped Lillian Hellman make her way onto the stage for the opening night of The Little Foxes with Elizabeth Taylor. So, I put it in my resume. Are you having a good time? Good. I had a little story in the back pocket about the night that the one fight that Gordon and I had in Culver City, and he threw his salad at me. But since we're having a good time, I'm just going to get on to the poetry. Michael had the wisdom to not make it all about testimony. So tonight I thought I would do a little poem. I wrote this for the 35th anniversary of CTG. But here we are at the 50th and this gorgeous celebration of Gordon. So a poem, like a play, is a living, breathing organism until we pass. So here it goes. It's called The Ancients. It starts with a vision, not just a vision, but a real desire to take it on, to say something about our world, not about how wonderful yesterday was or how great tomorrow will be, but what it was like to be here today, in this now, this complicated, exhilarating time in history. And in our tribe, there's always someone who wants to take it on, isn't there? And it's usually the artistic director, the spirited young leader who is equal parts diplomat, Buddha, bully, visionary, and the person who thinks that the gods have given him 36 hours in his day. We call them the ancients because once they start, they never stop. Taking it on has its consequences. They'll say you're nuts. They'll say it's too ambitious. Someone might even tweet that you're overrated. They threaten to take back the money. They question your artistic integrity. They write funny things about you in the paper. They think you don't know what you're talking about, but he did. He had a vision, and it was simple. The mission was to tell the story of today, because today is full of a lot of drama, and it's been that way through history. We are a fragile, contradictory humanity. We forge ahead while repeating all our best mistakes. He was right. We didn't have to go far for the story. It was underneath layers and layers of corruption, and on the top floor of boardrooms, and in the bedrooms of the not so rich and famous, in the everyday of Los Angeles. Everyone has a story. Every story is a poem. And in the theater, we get to make drama of the extraordinary everyday. Your colleagues become acquaintances, your friends become colleagues, your actors become enemies, your enemies become your lovers, your lover becomes an actor. But we plow ahead because it's the right thing, only nobody else knows it yet. And that's the moment when we become artists. That's the moment when we walk through fire, we jump off the cliff, we decide to tell the truth 24 hours a day. So we take a risk. And I'm not talking about leaving your car with the valet kind of risk. A real, real risk. And why? Because we've seen it. The laughter, the love, the heartache, the regret, the sweet memory, the brutal anger, the unbelievable joy, the violent passion, the broken bodies, the healing performance. And more importantly, we take the risk because we know those feelings from our own hearts. So we get a vision. A desire to say something about the world. And it is at this moment, at the intersection of great possibility, that we walk into the theater to start to do our work. Not that we need a theater, mind you, but people want to come more when you have one. Especially when you have a stage like this one that says, you want to be excellent? Great, you can be excellent here. And that was a gift that he gave to many of us. A space, some time, a little money, and a lot of opportunity. He encouraged the cultural collision. We became family and we fought like one, but always towards his simple vision. And that's where we find each other, in the theater, telling stories the old way, but with new ideas. The playwright who rips open his heart each time, searching for the raw public bleeding. The designer who looks at a shape and makes an image, that makes a metaphor, that tells a story, that sells a ticket. The director who paces backstage, drinking his life away, wondering if he made the right decision. They are the breath of what makes a story. And so this evening, I am breathing in the designers, the actors, the crew, the mentors, the board, and yes, even the development department. Blessed is the development department. They're going to get to heaven fully funded and on budget. Because every day, a story waits to unfold. A city arches its back. and reveals its colors. A language gets spoken. A person gets lost. A building transforms. A wound gets healed. A body breaks open. And we get to tell the stories that make the difference, that reveal the lies, that make us laugh, that make us horny, that make us human, that give us hope, that heal the heart, that calm the fear, that get the facts, that set the record straight, that make us want to be better human beings. Everyone has a story. Every story is a poem, and it always starts with the empty page and the pen bleeding onto the canvas of a stage. A stage like this one that sits on county property, Los Angeles County, Aboriginal home of the Tongva and the Chumash, home to more than 10 million people coming from more than 140 countries, speaking 224 identified languages. How's that for a potential still untapped audience? We haven't even begun to tell the story of Los Angeles. So this is what I learned from the ancient. Never mess with an actor's paycheck. Don't try to give someone new lines on their dinner break. Get to know every person you produce. Become friends, lovers, whatever, because you are going to ask extraordinary things of them in the process of collaboration. There were a great many artists before us and a great many who will come after us. So we must tell the story of today with great respect, responsibility, and understanding of the privilege that we have to be the translators, the channelers, the interpreters of our culture. This ability to see, to translate, already places us in the avant-garde. And because of that, we must take great risk and experiment and even court failure for the joy of moving the field forward. There will be plays that no one will want to see, and artists that no one will know that we should produce. It's not the Pulitzer Prize-winning play, but the six that came before from that writer that we need to get to now. In the car coming home from a show in San Diego, or having cream spinach late after notes at Kendall's, or meeting in the halls in the annex at 3 a.m., maybe the greatest lesson I learned from the ancient was that all of this is ephemeral. It is the live art, going back to the Greeks and beyond. It lasts only for the moment on that night when that audience experiences just that way for the first and the last time. Because it is so brief, this time on our planet, we must make it matter. We must use all of our artistic powers, even the ones you don't think you have, and make your life and art the most powerful work to come out of you. Death is the norm. Life is the miracle. And Gordon's life was an epic play. But most of all, the one Gordon lesson I will always remember, leave the door open for possibility. Thank you.
He was a real friend of the theater, and I felt he was very loyal, and I think that's important. And I felt he made a real commitment to me and my work, and other playwrights feel the same way. And that's important, loyalty, I think, because we don't always knock it out of the park, and someone's got to be there when we write our Two Gentlemen of Verona, and not there just for our Hamlets and King Lear's, and he did that for us, and he will be remembered and always with great gratitude, and I'm very proud that I had such a strong association with him and his theaters in my career.
I just miss him. He's one of those people, you know, in your life, there are people that you can't quite imagine the world without. Not because you talk to them every day, but because they are seminal figures. And Gordon was a seminal figure in the American theater and someone who loved it. And so the great thing about Gordon had exactly as much imagination for a new play, or enthusiasm for a new play that had just wandered in that might be of interest, as he had for gigantic projects like Angels and like Suit Suit. And that enthusiasm, even when he dozed from time to time during the process, was infectious. It made you think that this was an important thing to do. And there was this tricky thing about Gordon's dozing through things, that if you could swear that he wasn't there, but if you asked him what had happened, he was. He was. It was his way. My friend Sybil Pearson did quite a lot of work with Gordon, and she used to talk about, she had a psychiatrist once who was quite an old person and who would fall asleep in the sessions, and Sybil would accuse her of falling asleep, and she would always say, "No, no, I have just gone inner." And I think that's what Gordon did. He just went inner.
Gordon and we, the Globe and Center Theater Group, had decided to go halfies on this rather ambitious, very interesting play that had been begun to be developed here in New York and was looking for further development, which was the way to do it. And he called me up and he said, "Don't you think we should do this together?" And I said, "That's a great idea." And he said, "We'll do it first." And I thought, well, that's dumb, because you're in town and we're out of town. Wouldn't you rather have us get the thing going and then you take it on? No, he said. "No, I think it'll be better to start here. I've got the engine to do all this," which God knows was true. So we all agreed on everybody who was going to do it. And we started. And we were very hands-off, but very pleased with ourselves. One might say smug. And the phone rang one day, and it was Gordon. He said, "Jesus, you've got to get up here. It's terrible." And I said, "Well, what am I going to do?" And he says, "Well, you're my partner. You better do something." So, God, we laughed. We laughed so hard. I came up and saw it, and indeed, it was woebegone. It was pretty bad. And the director, God rest his soul, no longer with us, so I can't do any damage there, was completely baffled. And we sat him down, and Gordon said, in that wonderfully calm, avuncular voice, "And how can we help you?" He said he didn't know, but he was baffled by the technical rehearsal. I said, "Oh, I know, I'll tech it. You go to the desert and rest." We sent him to the desert to rest. Of course, he never came back. It was dumped onto me, and we mercifully closed it and did not take it to San Diego. I did have the last laugh, because Gordon got saddled with it and I didn't. That was great. But we laughed every time we got together about that unholy alliance that really could have sunk lesser spirits than ours, but didn't even dent the surface.
I'm Oscar Eustace, Artistic Director of the Public Theater. But more importantly tonight, I'm the former Director of New Play Development of the Mark Taper Forum. I'm also bearing greetings from Peter Wexler, Gordon's longtime friend and designer, who wanted me to tell you that Gordon was the son of Skipper Davidson. Skipper was a beloved teacher and an ancient Jew. Gordon was born an ancient Jew. All his life, he sat on a rock outside our cave under the stars, stoking the embers of the fire. We all sat on rocks with him around the fire while he simply asked, "Who were we? Who are we? Who might we become?" Gordon will never really die if we all continue to ask, "Who were we? Who are we? Who might we become?" I loved him. Peter. In 1989, Gordon Davidson offered me a job. We'd spent a weekend sitting around a table at an artistic director's West Coast gathering, and at the end of that time, Gordon said, "I don't want to interfere with what you've got going on at the Eureka," which was my theater in San Francisco, "but I'd like you to consider coming to work for me." A few days later, I wrote him and said, My company is falling apart. I've broken up with my girlfriend. My father just died, and socialism has failed. It's 1989. I don't know what I believe in anymore, but I believe in this play. If you'll produce it, I'll come work for you. The next day he called me and said, yes, he'd be thrilled to produce this brilliant play. Come on down. The play was the first half of Angels in America. Gordon did indeed produce it, and he did an amazing job. And I went to work for a legend. Gordon was one of the giants of the regional theater movement, the man who had produced The Trial of the Catonsville Nine and The Matter of J. Robert Oppenheim, Sharrow Box, Children of a Lesser God, and, oh Jesus, Zoot Suit. He had built his theater on two fundamental beliefs, that the theater had its own unique contribution to make to the great debates in our society, and that the way to unleash that power was to support artists in their growth and ambitions, no matter how huge or seemingly foolish. Gordon also understood deeply the power that the theater has to let people tell their own story. The theater was where the oppressed and the marginalized could reclaim their agency, could make themselves the subjects, not the objects of history, could literally put themselves center stage in the spotlight. He knew that the better angels of our American history grew from this country of immigrants, grew from an ever-expanding enfranchisement of all our people, and that the theater could play a significant role in that process. He had an enormous impact. He changed everything. He was the only person I ever called boss. I stayed at the Taper 5 difficult and glorious years. Those were the years of Kentucky Cycle, of Angels, of Twilight Los Angeles. We had a pretty good run. And Gordon taught me everything I know about running a theater. His enormous energy sprang from an insatiable curiosity that may have sometimes bordered on attention deficit disorder, but created an astonishingly lively and amazing theater. His optimism and his joy were admirable and infectious. He worked harder than anyone I have ever known to this day. He had remarkable generosity, an enormous heart. The first show I directed at the Taper was a rough ride in all ways. A couple of months after that show closed, Gordon asked me to a lunch at the Music Center. He'd gathered a wonderful group of directors, Tom Moore, Jose Quintero, Ron Link, among others, and he asked us all to reflect on the shows we'd done that had failed and what we'd learned from them. It was an amazing conversation, and in my narcissistic blindness, it was only at the very end of the lunch when I suddenly realized that Gordon had put this together for me to help me process and survive that difficult first show. Nobody had ever done such a thing for me. Nobody else has to this day. How I wish he was here to talk about what we must do in these difficult days we're now facing. He isn't. But I know his legacy lives on and on and on. Gordon lives on in the amazing institutions he built here in Los Angeles, the Taper, the Douglas, the Ahmanson, Center Theater Group. Gordon lives on wherever theaters are aspiring to change the world. Gordon lives on wherever people are demanding that they be given the stage, that they be allowed to tell their own stories. Gordon lives on wherever theaters are backing artists, urging them and supporting them in becoming their best and biggest selves. And Gordon lives on at the Public Theater in New York. I may be sitting in Joe Papp's chair, but it was Gordon who made me, and his legacy I'm carrying. Thank you. It's my honor and pleasure to introduce Gordon's amazing daughter, Rachel Davidson.
So this has been a celebration, an amazing celebration, but I'm the one up here with Kleenex. And this is what happens when you come towards the end of an evening. I have to edit my material because some of you used it, but that's okay. So bear with me. My entire life, I shared my father with all of you. Maybe it's a second child thing, but I was never jealous of you. I actually thought you were lucky to have his attention too. Since Dad has passed away, And in fact, even before then, the number of people who have written and told me how encouraging he was to them, how he was a father figure, a Moses, a G-dog, a mentor, a protector, supportive and present. These essential qualities make sharing him with all of you for all these years feel even better. There were plenty of moments when it seemed a bit unfair to have to share, but far more moments when Dad's love of his work enriched my life beyond compare. In these last few years, especially after the robust Dad who I relied on became a bit more frail and delicate, the time I spent with him hearing about his worries and concerns over finishing his memoir, or about moving from their home of 50 years and where to put all that stuff, it's not that it gave me time back, but I am trying to find comfort in that we were connected and our time was a treasure. Growing up, people would ask me, what was it like to have a dad who was so busy, traveled so much, needed to be downtown all day and then again by half hour, and was so committed to his work. As a kid, it was all I knew. It just was. He worked. He loved his work. He wore jeans that embarrassed me, yes, Jonathan Lee. His rehearsal pants were too short, flared out too much, rode down too low. In fact, I stole them and framed them to assure they'd never be worn again. That's teenager's revenge. I couldn't have really understood that while wearing those jeans in rehearsal room A, he was creating and building and contributing to major works in the American theater. He was all that, but he was also just my dad. Always wanting to fix things and driving carpools to school. Once I could drive, he was always up early, ready to wipe off the morning dew from the car as I drove off. He was the one to stay up late and help me type my school papers. And during those years when I just couldn't speak to my mom without that awful pubescent grimace, sorry, Mom, somehow I could speak with my dad. He would tune into something that seemed off with me, and even though if I declared, you don't understand, and his response of, help me to understand, sent me and my brother into spasms of teenage angst, he had a way of quietly listening, and that helped. Growing up, Davidson, I know that my dad cherished our family time. Trips were often because of or certainly included something theater-related. New York frequently, but also Santa Fe for opera, London for a potential import, Denver to celebrate the opening of the Denver Theater Center, Spoleto, Italy, when Children of a Lesser God was presented at the Spoleto Festival. The only time a Davidson trip was not because of or in search of theater was when we would travel on Christmas Day to Mexico for winter break, and I would witness my dad embrace his sun-worshipping vacation like a pro. That man could switch to vacation daiquiri nap mode like no other, matched by my mom, and always on our trips, the ever-present briefcase and tote bag filled with scripts and his leather Bible of dates and appointments and a season to fill sat right by his side. Dad made sure that Adam and I had the opportunity to be exposed to everything. Mnuchin's 12-hour Agamemnon trilogy in French, Robert Wilson, Philip Glass, Leonard Bernstein conducting the Boston Symphony Orchestra at Tanglewood, seeing the classics, experiencing new voices. It mattered to him that we experience all kinds of art and express ourselves, our points of view, our likes and dislikes. As our dear friend and dad's forever associate, Ken Brecker, realized once when he took me to see something at the Ford Theater, I think, and it wasn't great, when he leaned over to suggest that perhaps we could leave at intermission, and I said without a doubt, Davidsons don't leave. Lesson learned. The summer of 1976, Dad directed Otello with Zubin Mehta conducting the Israeli Philharmonic. Adam and I went along with Dad for a month while Mom had to stay back for a while to tend to her own workload. Adam and I attended so many rehearsals that it led us both to declare that we wanted to be in the opera. That clearly wasn't part of Dad's plan. His plan was open the opera and then travel to meet Mom in Paris. Adam was allowed to hold a spear for a rehearsal or two, and I set my mind to memorizing the entire Italian libretto phonetically and performed it incessantly to prove I could go on. The answer was still no, and that inspired Adam to create a portrait of my father that still hangs near his desk. Phone handsets to create a face, one in the center, one on either side, and the caption reads, you go here, you go there, and no, Adam, you cannot be in the show. I have to admit, but this is not to say that Adam or I long to be performing in the theater, but for certain we long to be with our dad and to experience him. I have to admit, I realize now I took him for granted, and I took the creative, curious, exploratory life he provided us as a given. After all, I was just a kid who loved that my dad let me listen to a Billy Joel tape on repeat every time he drove the carpool. But I cannot deny that his work ethic, his passion, his commitment seeped into my soul. Getting my first real job in New York after college, working in the theater, I wanted to do it on my own, so I didn't tell anyone who I was related to until I got the job. Of course, the moment I told my parents, my father said in his protective father mode, "That man has a reputation as a womanizer." I love that he was all dad in that moment, and also how my association with not wanting to be known as Davidson's daughter turned into absolutely thrilled to be. While in that theater job, I inherently knew it mattered that I know every staff member, a member of the staff, interns, apprentices, that I acknowledge their work, that I'd be there a half hour to check in and put out fires and give words of encouragement, that I invest myself completely into the community. It paid me back a million times over in the lifelong friendships and an understanding that creating art doesn't just come solely from one person. The team of creative people, the support of the managers, the attendance by the audience, all of that mixed together makes the art come alive. Our house hosted many dinner parties. Our guest house boarded many travelers. There were myriad times when I wake up in the morning, come downstairs and declared, "Patchouli Man is here." That would be the ever-talented set designer and dear friend Peter Wexler, who you just heard Oscar read a letter from, having arrived late from New York, and gone straight outside to the guest house, leaving his scent behind. Once, I came downstairs to find Arthur Miller at the kitchen table, and perhaps with some encouragement, I dared to share my school essay with him, and yes, of course, let him correct and make some improvements. See, I'm no idiot. See, all of you who came to dinner or stayed at the house were superior in their field. Working writers, talented actors, creative designers. It painted a picture of a creative life to me that once I ventured out on my own, I realized is rare. That being said, my parents loved caretaking for and mentoring new talents, the underpaid theater actor, and the biggest thrill of all was witnessing a friend succeed. As many of you have mentioned, if Dad could be here now, my memory of him would be bounding up on this stage with typical energy and unparalleled enthusiasm to welcome you to the theater, to the opening night of a play that addresses uncomfortable, unusual, previously ignored, thought-provoking, and not always perfect material. The current landscape would have been ripe for Dad to find that voice, that Tony Kushner, that Robbie Bates, that Sybil Pearson, that Marcia Norman, that Anna Deavere Smith, to help us decipher our world a bit better. He might have given out a Skipper Award, named in honor of his own father, to someone who had worked tirelessly at the theater, not necessarily the most visible player, but rather the person who is part of the foundation, the fabric of how this place works. He would have embraced that person warmly, he would have thanked you all for coming, and he would have enjoyed every praise and welcomed every criticism in an effort to make the show better and even more meaningful. I miss that person. That person showed me that even the most unpopular point of views matter. That person taught me that giving a voice to the other and the unflattering side of ourselves has a place and must be exposed. We were kind of other growing up here too. Parents were transplanted New Yorkers. My mother still hangs on to a certain Brooklyn-tinged word. Apparently orange starts with an A. We lived a theater-centric life in a town that valued Hollywood and money and fame. My parents treasured our family, and since our own grandparents, cousins, and family were mostly on the East Coast, they cherished friends as family and always welcomed in those who were in search of connection. Many of you here today experienced that kindness, that eternal openness, and blurring of friends and family lines. And as Tom Moore suggested, my mom and dad did make a great team. For 58 years, they would enter a room, both with great presence and big smiles, and Dad would embrace you, perhaps frump your name, but Mom was always there filling in the correct hellos and how is your daughter or son, accurate names included. You subscribers were Dad's most favorite of all, and you really are everywhere. We might be traveling through an airport or on that beach in Mexico, and there was always someone who took a second look at Dad to greet him, mention their most or least favorite production, and it mattered. In these final years, being remembered, noticed in a crowd, reminded of the great works he shepherded that gave my dad such strength, such sense of purpose and pleasure. Even meeting my friends, he was always warm and engaged, but as in the case of my friends Mark and Julie, it was Mark who gushed that his mother had always been a subscriber and took him to the theater throughout his childhood. So Mark's name, Dad remembered. It's true. Even though he could get caught up about talking about his own plans, his thoughts, his needs, Dad was my advocate, always asking me about what I thought I should do next and his belief I could do just about anything. It's hard to live up to that kind of complete passion for work and complete belief that you have chosen the right path. It's a search I feel in some ways has intensified for me lately. I know he took great pride in Adam's work as a director and incredible joy in our spouses, Jeff and Jessica, and in all five of his grand girls. Here they are. Dad was an incredible grandfather, totally unexpected. I thought that for certain I had made him wait too long for grandkids, and that after the love he showered on Piers Brecker, that he would have nothing left for my, at that point, unborn children. Plus, no time to play with kids when there are plays to produce, but I was so wrong. One could never have imagined that the same man who did all that important Tony Award, Pulitzer Prize, Ovation Award winning theater completely relished in the role of Papa and would babysit at our home reading the paper or watching TV until Jeff and I came home, and then he'd go on and on about the adorable and whip smart thing that our child had done. See, now this line just doesn't fit. Because thank you, Michael, Neil, Phyllis, and Patricia. See, the thing is, this event is overwhelming to me. It's so beautiful. And yes, Michael, Richie, Neil Keller, Phyllis, and Patricia, the wonderful staff here, current and past, and all of you for this celebration, it means everything. Just today, my Uncle Michael, yes, the one who looks just like Gordon and might have caused a double take or two, he and I visited the Special Collection Archives at UCLA Young Library. After years of consideration, Dad decided to gift all of his papers, memorabilia, production scripts, correspondence to UCLA. After meeting with the archivists, my uncle and I felt so strongly that this was the exact right place for these archives to be. Not only will Dad's nearly 40 years of CTG-related work be housed in a place where the group theater was born, but also alongside the papers of John Houseman, who was an early champion of Dad, and as a young controversial director, and Franklin Murphy, as you heard, a board member and UCLA chancellor, and CTG's full archived history as well. Ultimately, the potential for Dad's work to help influence the next generation of theater artists, socially conscious scholars, and historians is a real possibility. In my family, we will tell the stories of our papa, our Zadie, and try to honor his memory. And I hope that you, our dear friends, will also carry on his dreams and commitment to what theater can do for each one of us and our humanity. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Lilius White. Thank you. I'm very happy to be here tonight to celebrate the life of Gordon Davidson. I didn't know Gordon well, or for very long, but I worked at the Mark Table Forum the first time 13 years ago in a show called Like Jazz, written by Cy Coleman and Alan and Marilyn Bergman. Yeah. We had a great cast, but there was, you know, with any new work, there's always some stuff that goes on. I remember Pat Birch was choreographing a number for me, and there was an issue with me going backwards down a ladder. I had read on the side of the ladder and said, "Do not go backwards down the ladder." So Pat Birch and I had a little discussion about it, and finally it was resolved I'm sure that Gordon had a lot to do with getting the crew to come on and build the thing that needed to be built for me to go up and down the ladder so I could get up and off the piano. And anyway, I remember this time because this was the time that my first grandchild was being born. And Gordon was so delighted and excited for me. And there was such a twinkle in his eye and such a gush of love and energy and hopefulness and excitement for me. And I remember leaving the theater and driving to Las Vegas in time to get there for the birth of my grandchild with all of this love and energy behind me. He was the wings to this organization. And he helped Like Jazz fly. So tonight with my friend Bill Cantos, who was also a part of Like Jazz, we're gonna do a song for you from Like Jazz that was written by Alan and Marilyn Bergman and Cy Coleman. It's all about living now. When we are making music, we're in a world of our own. No windows, no clocks, no headlines. But somewhere the clocks are ticking, and they cannot be denied. Step outside. Before the here and now becomes the where or when, before the time we know becomes the there and then.
Remember where we are and memorize it all. Long as the world is faithfully before we lose the light. Before we lose the light. Before the here and now becomes the where or when.
I don't dare let go of this Kleenex because I've been sniffling through the entire evening. Anyhow, what Brooklyn accent? I think I've been sent out here to clear the house. I have no notes, but I did remember something I said at Gordon's funeral service.
If I had known how important he was, I would have treated him better. But Gordon truly thought that he had been forgotten. And I have to say, seeing his beloved audience here in these theaters that were his life, I know he was wrong. I don't know how any work has gotten done at Center Theater Group this past month, because Michael and Neil and Bob Egan have been so busy. The entire staff has worked so hard to make sure this was the incredible, wonderful evening that it's been. Thank you all for coming out. And my heart is just about bursting. Thank you.